Hey, I'm Ryan. I'm a Christian, and this is my story. Growing up, I never missed going to church. When I was 12, I accepted Christ as my Savior. I was even baptized. It undoubtedly was a very important decision. It even affected how I lived in high school. I mean, don't get me wrong, I had fun on the weekends. I had a girlfriend, a couple, but I was a normal high school kid. College was one big blur, but I did make it to church out of obedience. And after school, I married a great girl, and she's been a great influence on me. Life's been good. I have a house, three kids. I couldn't ask for more. I mean, sure, I worry about my future. I mean, my marriage, it could be better. And I need to spend more time with my kids, but things will be all right. I have my faith. You may not hear me talk about it a lot, but it's just because it's personal. But don't worry for me. My Jesus is real.
I want to welcome you again to Harvester. And just like Ryan's story isn't really about one person, but it's about us as disciples. Is Jesus truly who we say he is, or is he a prefabricated cultural thing that we've made? And so we are in a series on discipleship because we need to understand what following Jesus means. And that's why our series is called Follow the Leader. Okay, and before we go anywhere else, I know that what I'm about to say, I'm going to lose respect with a lot of guys. But I have to share this because it's important for the message. So, Matt, if you can show the following picture. This is a movie called, it came out in 2004, that's going to date us, okay? So when Julie and I were in college, 2004, and it's called Win a Date with Ted Hamilton. And it is the first chick flick that I watched willingly. Okay, no one forced me. No one tricked me into it. I just watched it willingly. And here's how it happened. I remember Julie and I were just starting to talk a little bit, and we went to a basketball game with the college, and on the way back, you know, her and I think someone else rode together, and we're like just starting to talk and to get to know each other. And she's like, you know, there's this movie that came out last year. Have you watched it? And it went that day with Ted Hamilton. And I'm like, no clue. I'm like, yeah, I think I heard about it. And, you know, she keeps talking about, I really like it. I want to watch it again. We should watch it. And I'm thinking, hint. So I'm like, yeah, let's do it. Let's totally do it. Okay, and all of a sudden, this chick flick, which I thought, you know, was definitely the epitome of any chick flick, I became really interested in watching it, right? With Julie, of course. You know, so we got together with a couple of friends and we watched it, I think. And it was just one of the first things that we did together. And here's one thing that I want you to understand. The other one was Sleepless in Seattle. How many of you remember that movie? Okay, You've Got Mail. All these chick flicks all of a sudden took a different spin in my life, right? And like all of a sudden they went like from I want to throw up in my mouth to like, yeah, I could watch that movie. Why not? You know, it sounds interesting. Sleepless in Seattle. Why not? But here's what happened. Then all of a sudden, during certain parts of our lives, we change the things that we do because people that we love, they like doing certain things. And so right now we're in a stage in life where you can ask me about just about any movies, you know, any kid movies, and I'll be able to tell, yep, we've watched them. Yeah, I've seen it. I slept through that one for sure. But at least we've watched it, okay, because we love our kids, and when they get excited about something, we want to get excited. We love our spouses, and so we want to do things to get them excited, even though for us it might not be, you know, shopping might not be that big of a deal. You know, walking around the mall in circles is not that interesting, but you do it sometimes because they like to do it. And so, at times, you know, things that we like to do become secondary because people that we love like to do other things. See, when Jesus said in Matthew 4:18 through 20 that he was going to, he talked, he was speaking to fishermen. He said, you know, come follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Here's what he meant. He meant that, one, a disciple, and we saw the first week, is someone who has to make the decision to say, I want to follow Jesus. It's something that you make up here in your head. But then a disciple, Jesus said, I will make you. So the Bible says that Jesus is the one that gives the transformation. So it happens a transmission at a level heart. And then he said, I will make you into something. Something that I want to make you into, fishers of men. And we're going to be talking about this week and next week with two different sides of it. The first one that we're going to talk about is that a disciple cares for the things Jesus cares for. A disciple cares for the things Jesus cares for. See, there are some things that are hard to teach. There are some things that, you know, are hard to learn. One of those things, if you like sports, is that killer instinct. Have you seen those people that just have a killer instinct when it comes to sports? My son Isaac, you know, he's the smaller one. He just has that. I didn't teach it. I can't claim that I taught it. We play around, but he has that killer instinct. He gets a soccer ball on his feet. He knows one thing: to take it to the goal. I've coached some other kids, also have it. You know, they just get the ball, they know to put it in there. It can be the same with basketball. And some other kids, they can be really good at a certain part of the game, but they don't have that killer instinct. That's hard to learn. See, caring for the things that God cares for is crucial for us to thrive as a disciple. If we want to be a disciple in the long term, we're going to have to care about certain things that the Lord cares for. And if we don't, it's going to be difficult to remain a faithful disciple of Christ. Now, here's the problem that I see in our society. Many times, we just are not there yet. I don't know about you, but you know, you can go to a Christian concert. And I love and hate that intermission in a Christian concert that you get. Because, you know, they always come with, you know, things like Compassion International, or, you know, they ask you to adopt a child, you know, you can sponsor a child, and you can, you know, give so that, you know, someone in the world has water. And here's one thing I've noticed about my heart, right? So it all sounds good, and it makes sense, and these organizations are there to change the world. But you know what? There's something deep inside that when they ask you to pick up the child, right, or to write a check or do something, it's like my heart sometimes it feels guilted into it, but I'm not encouraged to take a step. Have you ever felt that way, where you just feel guilted into some things because you're like, yeah, I should be doing it, but deep inside your heart, you don't have the desire to do anything about it. You feel bad for them, but that doesn't move you. And what I want to talk about is that exactly today. Is the fact that we don't want, you know, when we make Christianity, when we make discipleship into a checklist, you know, we go into part of Christianity that it shouldn't be there. Part of following Jesus, that we made it as a church culture, you know, not Harvester, but in general, churches today in the 21st century, have turned Christianity into a bunch of checklists of to-dos and don't-dos that if we aren't aware of our hearts, you know, we can fall into that trap. And then it all becomes pointless, and just, you know, and you lose the joy in your relationship with the Lord. You don't let the Holy Spirit work in your life because you have turned something that's supposed to be life-changing and organic into something that is just on paper. It's like we revert to the law. And so how do we care for the things that Jesus cares for? One of the things that we need to realize is we need to ask, what does Jesus care for? And for that, we need to go to Luke chapter 19. We're going to be working out of two main passages, one in Luke 19, one in Matthew 25. But what does Jesus care for? Here's what happens. He was on his way to Jerusalem, and he stops in a town named Jericho. And in this town, Jesus does something that is going to give us a glimpse into what he cares for. And I'm just going to read this part. Luke 19, verses 1 through 10 says, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him. Since Jesus was coming that way, when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, he has gone to the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount. Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost. The Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost. Jesus cares for the lost. Jesus cares for the people that are lost. And in a culture, I'm just going to use the biblical term, because in our culture, you know, I've heard people get offended if you call them lost. But let's determine what a lost person is. A lost person is a person that is lost in sin. That have lost their way with the Lord because of something that has happened in their lives. Maybe because they don't know about Jesus. They don't know who God is. Maybe they grew up a certain way. But sin, all of a sudden, has trapped them and they are lost. And we've all been there. I don't know about you, but we've been lost at some point. But since the beginning of his ministry, Jesus cared about the people that were lost, the people that were far off. Here's one thing for us to think about. You know, as Christians, sometimes we tend to be really harsh on people that don't know the Lord. And you know what Jesus did? He did exactly the opposite. He was really kind to people that didn't know the Lord. He was really kind to people that didn't know about Scripture. He was really kind and patient with people that were sinners, people that were lost. Yet, he was a little bit more straightforward and blunt and sometimes even harsh with the people that claim to be Christians. And see, in our society, sometimes we have it backwards. We're expecting people that don't know God to act like people that know God. But we yet we let, you know, a lot of people that know the Lord, you know, we don't keep each other accountable. We treat each other, you know, just let things slide. And so here's what happens. Jesus travels to this town, and Zacchaeus, a tax collector, a chief tax collector. The Bible says that he was a chief tax collector and wealthy. So he goes, and this was a short man. So I want you to think about this. Tax collectors in the time of Israel were viewed upon as traitors because they saw Rome as a threat, and Rome collected taxes, and then, you know, they knew that those taxes were going to be to empower this kingdom that had all kinds of false gods. And then they saw people that collected taxes for them, Jewish people, as people who had betrayed God. They had sold themselves to this Roman Empire. They had sold themselves to this worldly power in order for them to become rich, to make, you know, to become wealthy. Straight with just getting their salary, they could charge more taxes. You know, there were few accountability systems, so they could charge, you know, as much as they wanted, especially the chief tax collector. He could charge the people that were under him a lot more, so they would in turn have to charge people a lot more, and he would become extremely wealthy. Now, on top of that, physical defects in Israel were viewed as a sign that they were displeasing God, that someone was displeasing. And so if you were maybe, the fact that the Bible mentions he was really short, we don't know if it was something, you know, just like any other short person, or if it was maybe a disease that he had when he was little, or if he, for whatever reason, you know, wasn't able to grow. Whatever it is, you know that Zacchaeus was not liked. He was, in fact, probably hated among the Jewish culture. Yet Jesus goes, and as he's walking by, Zacchaeus is interested about this man. So he gets up on this tree, a sycamore tree that had low branches, so he was able to climb up there. And Jesus goes straight to him and says, hey, I must go to your house today. I have to go. Like if it was an appointment that he had, like if Jesus already had a divine appointment with Zacchaeus. And so Zacchaeus gets down. He's amazed that this rabbi that everybody's talking about all of a sudden is asking him to go to his house. And so he gets down, he takes Jesus to his house and throws a banquet. Now, while there, everybody's there, you know how people are, right? It's like we can be there, but they were talking about Jesus. They were talking about Zacchaeus. They were talking about how Jesus was in the sinner's house. And Zacchaeus, they do it, and they're not even being careful because Zacchaeus probably gets a hold of it. And he turns around and he thinks, not knowing Jesus very well, he just says, hey Lord, he just knows that Jesus cares for the lost. He just knows that Jesus cares for the sick and the poor. And so he's like, I'm going to do the same. So he says, I'm going to give half of my possessions away. And if I've cheated anyone, I'm going to repay them back four times as much. Now, Jesus didn't ask him to do that. Jesus never said anything, never told Zacchaeus to do anything. See, being in the presence of Jesus changes some things in us. When you are in his presence and you want to continue to be in his presence, it makes you worry about the things that he cares. Just like for some of us, it means starting to watch movies that you wouldn't watch otherwise, right? Because we want to hang out with a certain person. Just like for some of us, it means when you get to know someone and they have a hobby, you know, it's a friend of yours, you might end up getting into the hobby because of that person. Just for some of us, it means watching kids' movies because our kids watch them. When you get to know Jesus, you get to do certain things that he likes to do. And you know what? He cares for the lost. You know why? Because Jesus sees us. God sees us not as who we are, but as who we could become. See, we need to start seeing the potential in people, not for what they have done, not for where they have been, but for where they, what they could become. I don't know if you knew this, but the 17th president of the United States, Andrew Johnson, did not know how to read by the age of 20. He didn't get to go to school. He was 20. He didn't know how to even read. His wife ended up teaching him how to read. He became an avid reader, and he kept climbing. You know, he was a good business person. He ended up being the president of the United States. You know, who could have imagined that a sophomore in high school that was rejected, you know, by the high school basketball coach team, you know, would end up changing the way that we look at basketball. Michael Jordan, you know, he didn't make the team his sophomore year, yet he went on, he kept trying, and someone finally saw that potential, you know, got him on the team, and he reshaped the game of basketball. Who would have known that a small company, you know, that now we know as Google, you know, would try to sell their idea for $1 million, and someone didn't see the potential, and now they're worth $82.5 billion. That's like 82,000 times more than it was. They thought it was worth. I mean, when we start seeing the potential in people, like God sees the potential in you and me, we start seeing the people differently. And that's what our hearts need to get used to. Seeing people, that person at work that you don't like, that person that is really rude, right? That person that you can't stand, you know, that person that, you know, kind of makes you uncomfortable. Those are the people that maybe you need to start looking at them different. You know, take the Gus, you know, part of you that looks at them and says, man, I don't know if I can trust them. I don't know why they act that way. And start looking at them through the eyes of Jesus and see, man, what could these people become if they accepted Jesus? And what could the Lord do for them? So Jesus cares for the lost. You know who? What else Jesus cares for? Jesus cares for the least, the overlooked. Let's go to the next passage in Matthew 25. Matthew 25, and this is one of the longest just the passages of teaching that we have recorded in Jesus. So Matthew 24 and 25, it's one of the last speeches that Jesus gave, the last teaching that he's given to his disciples. And he ends basically with this passage about the sheep and the goats. And it's a really interesting passage. There's so much about it. But I just want to, you know, touch on the heart of it, how Jesus ends this. He's talking about how everybody has been given talents right before this passage, and how God expects us to do something with the things that we have been given, whatever resources, whatever talents we have. And then this is what he says, verse 31, Matthew 25, 31, if you want to follow along with me. And Jesus starts saying, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Okay? So, if we weren't, who were that? Here are the sheep, here are the goats, okay? Sorry for the people that sit on the left side. Here the goats. Then the king will say to those on his right, Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance in the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him. What are you going to say? Everybody say Lord together. Ready? One, two, three. Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invited you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go visit you? And then the king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. Then he will say to those on the left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. They also will answer, and Lord, on three, one, two, three.
Lord,
when did we see you hungry, or thirsty, or a stranger, or needing clothes, or sick, or in prison, and did not help you? He will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. And what a way to finish this message, right? It's harsh. It's one of those things you're like, what is Jesus talking about here? One, there are different, interpretations to this, but I believe that Jesus was talking about what he's given us. And looking at the context, we always have to look at scripture within the context that it is. Jesus was telling his people, you have been given things, and you need to become like me. You need to have a heart like mine that cares for the least of these people. For the least of my brothers. He calls them my brothers. In a sense, he says, what you do to the least of these, you're doing them to me. You're doing that to me. Jesus was interested in the least of people. And you know what? We need to be interested in the least of people. Now, we know there's nothing we can do to earn heaven, right? There's no good deed that can get you into heaven. We know that it's solely by grace that we're justified by the blood of Jesus Christ. However, the point of this passage is that people that are disciples of him, disciples of Jesus, care for the things Jesus cares for. Disciples of Jesus have a changed heart to the point where you care for the same things that your Savior cares for. And you know what he cares for? He cares for the lost. He cares for the least, the overlooked people in our lives. You know why? Because he knows what the world really needs. See, it's not more laws that we need. We need more love. It's not more philosophy that we need. We need more action by people who love the Lord. It's not more fairness that we need. We need more care in this world. And so the question maybe needs to be for us, okay? So you know that he cares for the lost. He cares for the least. And so we're at that point in that Christian concert, right? Where they've told you the need. They've told you what you need to do. But now, here's where I show it many times in those places. It's like, okay, I want to, but I still feel like my heart doesn't care. So what do I do? What if I don't care? That's a question that we need to be asking. What if I don't care? And so if you don't care at this point about the lost and the least, about those people that you see in need, and you're not, you don't feel compelled to do something about it, I want you to think about a few things, okay? One, maybe the reason why you don't care is because you haven't become a disciple of Jesus yet. If you feel like, man, I really don't care about this, maybe you need to think, have I given my life to the Lord? Because I tell you what, unless you have surrendered to Jesus completely, unless you have, you have the Holy Spirit in your life, those desires will not appear on their own. It is the opposite. Our nature is to be selfish, is to say, man, I have this much. Our nature, human nature, is going to tell you, you need more. It's like, why just have this? You need more. So by ourselves, We can never just become, have the heart of Jesus. You need to accept Jesus. So maybe the first step for you right now is become a disciple of Jesus. If you become a disciple, then it may be a different issue. It may be that you have to learn about what Jesus cares for. Maybe you just didn't know. Maybe you just don't know what the lost look like. Maybe you just don't know what the least look like. You know what I want to encourage you to do? You find out what Jesus cares for. Exactly. You know how you can do that? You go to His Word. You get to know Him more. Okay? I don't know. We've all received those really thoughtful gifts from people. I don't know if you can say that, but I have. You know, it's one of those things that you'll mention something one time to someone. You know, but how cool is it when you get to just say, hey, I really like this kind of, you know, whatever, coffee or food or restaurant or this or that. And then someone comes back to you and later on and says, like, hey, you know, on your birthday or Christmas or something, and they say, you know, here's a gift for you. And is it that one thing that you mentioned that one time? That, you know, for some of you that's easy. And for some of you it might be easy to figure out what Jesus cares for. But for some of us that are hard-headed, you know, I usually have to, my wife has to say something one or two or three times. And then I'm like, oh, you want that. Okay. Then I learn. And then I can help with that. And you know what? You might be hard-headed like me. Then it's going to take us a little longer. But we need to investigate. I remember asking Julie's friends what she liked to do, what she didn't like to do, the restaurants that she liked, what she didn't. You know what? Because I liked her at the time. I love her now. I liked her at the time. And I wanted to be closer to her. And you know what? If you love Jesus, if you like Jesus, maybe you can say, I love Him, but I like Him. Just find out more about Him. You know what? You're going to fall in love with Him. And when you do, the more that you get to know Him, the more you're going to just know what He cares for. And lastly, you need to spend more time with your Lord. Spend more time with your Lord. I have a graphic, you know, that I've seen in a book called Real Life Discipleship. And it tells us to just, we should write down, you know, maybe when you have some time, you can do it on your folder if you want. I encourage you to write down what activities allow you to get the Lord better. Is it praying? Is it maybe reading scripture? Is it maybe worshiping, memorizing scripture? We threw a few things in there. Spending time with other Christians, serving others in His name. You know, and what I want to encourage you to do is to write on the other side, how often, how frequently do you do those things? See, because we can say we want to know Jesus, but then we don't do anything to actually get to know Him. You can say, I want to spend more time with God, but you need to figure out what things allow you to get to know Him better. You know, for me, I love getting into the Word. But I realize that, man, sometimes I just need to listen. I need to not just read because I want to read and I want to learn more about this and that. I just need to listen and spend some quiet time with God. You know, and so it's never a one thing. It's like eating carrots, you know. We know carrots are healthy, but if you just eat carrots and nothing else, you're not going to be a healthy person. You know, we all have to discover what are the things that allow me to be close to God in my life and then start doing them. You know, you might be doing some of them daily, but then some of them rarely or never. And we need to come up with a balance. You know, do I worship weekly? Am I worshiping weekly? Am I worshiping once a month? Is that enough? You know, I need to talk about, we need to, you know, think about, you know, do I memorize the scripture ever? Is there any scripture that I ever memorized, you know, that just really brings me back to a center, a place, you know, where I'm centered in the Word of God? And here's the thing about this chart, though. I'm not trying to give you a bunch of to-dos, okay? There's nothing you can do specifically to grow. You cannot make your heart change. It's just about an environment. It's about having your heart being ready for that growth that the Lord gives you. It's about, you know, fertilizing and watering and just keeping, you know, on top of the soil, which is your heart, Jesus said, so that He can grow you. So what can you do? You need to look for the overlooked this week. You just need to go and see, who are the people in my life? Who are the people at work, at my school, that are overlooked? You know, that person that's always eating lunch by themselves, that person that, you know, no one likes, that everybody thinks is annoying or obnoxious. You know, and maybe it's your chance to be Jesus to them. You know, to be Jesus and say, hey, we need to hang out sometime. Because they might be looking at you. They might be trying to say, hey, I know that person is a Christian, and I really want to get to know them a little bit better. But just like Zacchaeus, they don't have the courage to go there because they know who they are. And they're just looking at a distance, and what you need to do is you need to go to them and say, hey, let's hang out sometime. Or, hey, you know, I want to get to know you a little bit better. Who are the overlooked people in your life? James 1:27 says this. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. And you know what? That's what we're called to do, to look at the least of our brethren, to look at the least of the people that we know and be Jesus to them, to look at the lost, the people that don't know Him, and be Jesus to them. And I want you what our world, imagine what our world would be. I want you to watch this video that Doyle found, and I think it's good stuff. I want you to read what it says, and just think about how that applies in your life. You guys can play.